The specter of a bygone horror has risen once again in the state of Oregon, and we ain't talking COVID, sweetheart. Something far older and historically more menacing. A resident of Deschutes County in the Beaver State was stricken with the bubonic plague this past February 2024, at least the third such case in that state in the last 12 years. Not 1 month later, a New Mexico man suffered the same exact ailment. This time, it was fatal. This chilling resurgence serves as a stark reminder that the Black Death, the disease that ravaged medieval Europe and Asia, lives not in the history books, but in our very own modern world. Whatever day it is in your neck of the woods, here at Mortar and Ivy, it is 2 Minute Tuesday. I am the professor, and this is News of the Old. The bubonic plague, a grim reaper that danced macabre waltz through Europe, claiming the lives of anywhere between 15 and as many as 50% of that continent's population between 1347 and 1351, has cast a long shadow. The source of this latest infection is believed to be a pet cat. It lurks not only in the shadows of wild places, but can hitch a ride on the seemingly harmless creatures that inhabit them, innocently mewling a whisper of the devastation it could wreak if unchecked. Let us not be lulled into a false sense of security by the convenience of antibiotics. While antibiotics offer glimmering hope, they are not an impenetrable shield. At the time of this reporting, the Oregon patient in question survived, suffering no side effects positively to treatment. While only 2 cases already this year doesn't sound like very much at all, it is a spike in the data amidst an already troubling trend. In 2012, a 59-year-old welder in Oregon likewise fell victim to the Black Death's cold clutches after tearing a mouse from his pet cat's jaws. He survived thanks to the miracles of antibiotics, but in doing so lost his hand to the infections and therefore his livelihood. In 2015, a mere 9 years before the Deschutes County case, a teenage girl in Oregon likewise suffered the plague's chilling touch. Reports suggest the source may have been innocuous as a flea bite. True, reported cases in the United States have dwindled significantly since the 1970s, with an average of only 7 per year. However, 2015 witnessed 4 deaths in the United States, its highest annual toll in 30 years, and this seemingly low number belies a disquieting trend. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, report a troubling concentration of cases in the western United States, particularly in the southwest region, encompassing northern Mexico, northern Arizona, and southern Colorado, as well as the Pacific Northwest of Washington and Oregon. This persistence and localization suggest a potential reservoir for the plague, a simmering cauldron that could erupt with unpredictable consequences. Outside of the U.S., the plague is consistently more devastating. From 2010 to 2015, more than 3,000 sobering cases and almost 600 deaths were documented. Madagascar bears the brunt of this grim burden, accounting for roughly 3/4 of all new infections and fatalities. In January 2017, the World Health Organization confirmed a troubling outbreak in districts of Madagascar untouched since 1950, claiming the lives of 25 people. Most cases occur in developing nations where people may live in unsanitary conditions and outside the reach of immediate treatment. According to an article bullpenned in the National Institute of Health Journal and cited in the New Scientist, the latest concern is potential strains of the disease-carrying bacterium growing resistant to modern antibiotics. Yersinia pestis, a little single-celled monster with a taste for the dramatic, isn't picky about who it infects. It's one of the nastiest bacteria out there, responsible for all sorts of plague parties. The bubonic kind with the swollen lymph nodes, the lung-targeting pneumonic variety, and of course the blood-infecting septicemic plague. Multi-drug-resistant strains isolated from real patients highlight the pathogen's potential to evolve beyond the reach of current treatments. Furthermore, the recent history of plague as a documented weapon of bioterrorism underscores the urgency of preparedness. The World Health Organization's grim estimation, 150,000 potential cases of pneumonic plague from a mere 50 kilogram arsenal attack on a major city, paints a terrifying picture of a bioweapon's massive destructive power. While a drug-resistant plague and its use as a bioweapon looms large, critical knowledge gaps in vaccine development, immune response, and rapid diagnostics leave us precariously unprepared. These shortcomings leave us vulnerable, a sobering reminder that our fight against the Black Death is far from over. As for the exact magnitude of this threat, only science and time will tell. I've been the Professor. This has been 2-Minute Tuesday. You're always welcome in my neck of the woods.